WildTalkRadio.com.
Theme song!
This is the Firefly Funhouse! And I want to introduce you to some very special friends that I met along the way.
Hey, this is Adam Copeland, a.k.a. the Rated R Superstar.
Hey guys, this is Renee Paquette.
This is Kane from WWE.
This is WWE Superstar Drew McIntyre.
Hello, this is WWE Hall of Famer, the Heartbreak Kid, Shawn Michaels.
Hi, this is Bree.
And this is Nikki, and we're the Bella Twins.
This is Christopher Daniels, and what I like to do on my off days is listen to the rap, and now...
And it is awesome.
Satisfaction is guaranteed.
It's time to experience the award-winning The Rack.
Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
I love kickball.
I'm back, taking souls and digging holes.
I'm gonna break you, bitch, you hear me?
You can look, but you can't touch.
Ruthless aggression.
With your host...
They've been lying to you. Heroes don't exist. Y'all become addicted to the illusion of what a hero does for you. Have I mentioned that I was once addicted to eating sponges?
Lindsey Ward.
Look at me, woman.
And you can just call me Taker.
Oh my God, it's Taker. Taker, Taker, Taker. Does Taker hate me? Oh my God, it's Taker.
And she was a wicked, wicked child who spat and swore and chewed tobacco.
I like puppets.
Stickers!
And her producer, Sir Rockin.
My little creatures of the night will now experience the magical art of puppetry.
If you smell...
Ow!
What the game is playing!
Live on the Wild Talk Radio Network.
We're here.
Yowie wowie!
This is my brutality!
I eat sleep, bleed, the demons in your dreams. I eat sleep, bleed.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to The Rack right here on WildTalkRadio.com, brought to you by our friends over at MBG Films. Check them out. YouTube.com/MBG1211. And if you're listening to us over on RackRadioShow.com, WildTalkRadio.com, or directly on Twitch, thank you so much for tuning in. We greatly appreciate it. If you're on Twitch and you have to have a Prime Gaming sub available, we can use it here for free for 30 days. All you have to do is hit the little purple button down at the bottom of the screen, and you can subscribe for free. It is that simple. My mouth is very mouthy tonight. Anyway, you can also subscribe the regular way, follow the channel, hang out in chat, or listen to the archive. We are happy to have you any way we can get you. I'm your host, Lindsey Ward. Joining me, as always, is the ever faithful producer slash co-host slash handyman Sir Rockin.
We're here. We're live. We're doing a thing. It's a Thursday night. It's a couple days before Bash in Berlin. You can tweet us at Wild Talk Radio, at Record Radio Show, at Lindsey Ward. Come to WildTalkRadio.com, RecordRadioShow.com, or Twitch.tv/WTRLive to interact with us live. College football started, so watching that, it's on ESPN. One time.
Awesome. I almost said something else, and I was like, wait, I shouldn't say that. That would be bad. Regarding my mouth, y'all.
Shouldn't say things regarding my mouth.
Anyway, yes, there's footballs, there's Bastion Berlins, there's news, there's notes, there's all kinds of things. It's been an interesting week in the world of pro wrestling.
Some things we're not talking about. Not yet, anyhow.
We are waiting for confirmation on a few things before we talk about it, but there will be more news coming next week.
Maybe.
Maybe. We'll see. But we have news for this week, so we should jump right into it, brought to our friends over at mbgfilmsyoutube.com/mbg1211. So it is official. Wade Barrett is set to join Joe Tessitore on Raw this Monday, while Michael Cole and Corey Graves take over SmackDown on September 13th.
So I guess Cole has a week off somewhere.
I hope so.
And then Graves and Barrett will do SmackDown on next Friday, whatever that is. That's the 9th, I think. Or not September. He starts September 16th. But yeah, he starts this week. Who knows? I don't know. That's the last report I said. He has like a week there's a week gap, but as we've seen, everything is changing. Wade's now going to Raw. Tessitore is on Raw, so that should be an interesting one. We'll see how that goes. One other Raw. Nope, I forgot to put it in the sheet, but we'll look at it here. The Raw will be going to Saudi Arabia on the weekend of Crown Jewel in November. So it's going to be taped the Sunday after Crown Jewel, the next day after Crown Jewel in November, and airing on November 4th from Saudi Arabia.
Interesting.
Well, they did SmackDown last time from the Kingdom.
Yeah, so it makes sense.
So now they're going to do Raw. Which probably means that SmackDown is taped the week before.
Yeah, probably.
Well, for travel purposes, they would tape it the week before so everyone could travel to Saudi Arabia, do Crown Jewel and then Raw. Unless they add SmackDown on, which they could. Who knows? We'll see.
It will be soon to be announced, whatever it is.
Yes, but that the Raw one was announced today.
So, big congratulations to Humberto Carrillo and Nikki Cross, as they have both re-signed with WWE.
Yeah, so they've been negotiating with Nikki for a little bit, and they came to terms in the last couple weeks. Same with Humberto. Good on him. Nikki probably got a nice, with how everything is going with the Wyatt 6 stuff, she probably got a nice contract.
I hope she did. I sincerely hope she did. She deserves it. I mean, she's been working her butt off for him, so she definitely deserves it.
Yeah, so it's nice that they're keeping her in the fold. That's a good sign. Berto's re-signing. That's a good sign for him. You tell who they're signing in and not, if they keep you around, that's a good thing. You have a little bit. You have a little bit of job security that you're not going to be on the chopping block right away.
No, you can tell that they're identifying who they want to keep and who they don't. Like, there is definitely a much more, like, strict system in terms of them maintaining the roster than there has been in the past.
Right, and we're seeing a lot of these deals, like, coming together because a lot of them were redone in 2019, right before the pandemic. Everything was, like, kind of, when NXT, the people who were, like, on NXT deals, they got some new deals because NXT moved to USA, so those contracts are coming up, and a lot of people re-signed in 2019 or now have to figure out their new contracts this year. That's kind of why we're seeing a lot of signings and re-signings and some people, you know, going in free agency.
Yep, so good on them. Congratulations. Next one. Oh, boy. This is going to be an interesting watch. The 6-part Vince McMahon docuseries Mr. McMahon is coming to Netflix on September 25th, 2024. Mr. McMahon chronicles the rise and fall of Vince McMahon, controversial businessman and co-founder of WWE, from his transformation of the WWE from a small regional business to a global entertainment powerhouse to the explosive sexual misconduct allegations that led to his eventual resignation. This 6-episode series offers a deep dive into McMahon's life and his enduring franchise. Culled from over 200 hours of interviews with McMahon himself prior to his resignation, his family members...
That's key right there.
Prior to the resignation, his family members, that's also key, business associates and some of the most iconic names in wrestling history, as well as the journalists who uncovered McMahon's allegations, filmmaker Chris Smith of Tiger King fame, and executive producer Bill Simmons, 30 for 30, present an unflinching, no-holds-barred look at one of the most enigmatic figures in sports entertainment.
Huh. So they did not talk to Janelle Grant.
No.
Remember, I was just making sure that's clear to people. She was never talked to, which I didn't expect her to be. With how this has probably been put together and it's been years in the making, and at least 3 or 4 years in the making.
Well, they've been working on it for a while, yeah.
Yeah. I'm feeling like the ending of it took a different turn than they were probably presenting. Originally when they pitched it, because they did 200 hours of interviews with Vince. Yeah, so it'll be interesting to see how it goes. So Bill Simmons did a lot of the work for 30 for 30s, the really good ones back in the day on ESPN. He now works for Spotify and The Ringer. And he's been a wrestling fan since he was a child. So, he's fully ingrained in everything that's going on. So when this was originally announced years ago, when they first, said, hey, this is going to happen, it's like, well, Bill Simmons behind it. Interesting. And the filmmaker for Tiger King just adds a whole nother level of strange to it. I'm looking forward to watch it. I'm feeling we're going to learn a couple things, but probably not a lot. Yeah, should be one of those. People are going to be talking about it, and people are probably going to complain they didn't touch on enough, mainly about the newer stuff.
Well, they can't really touch on it because there's an ongoing investigation on it.
Oh, I know. I'm just saying that people will be mad that they don't go deeper into it. It's like, but you got to realize stuff like this is already produced, put together, and was in the process of being finished when all this happened. And then they had you can't do a positive story on Vince after everything happened. So they had to rewrite probably the last episode of what they were trying to tell for it. So it'll be interesting. It's going to be something interesting to see.
I would be very curious to see how kind or unkind they are to Vince. If you've seen Tiger King, which a lot of us have, and it's coming from the same filmmaker, this is going to be something to watch. Because you're right, we will hear things that we didn't, or that we did know, but I bet there's a lot more that comes out that we don't know. And I'm very curious to see what wrestling names they got to talk about, like Vince. Because obviously when things are good and they're talking about how Vince was like making stars, that's probably where they're going to show up. But it would be interesting to see if anybody shows up, especially towards the end, talking about sort of what they knew and what they didn't know, which again, there's an ongoing investigation on a both a federal and state level. So it depends on how much of that they can show, if they can show anything. This is going to be a thing, though. The real thing that I expect to get blown open is the family relationship, and kind of it finally come out sort of like that Vince and Linda are either separated or they are divorced, or they are just staying together for the look of the thing, which I think we all have known for years as sort of what's been going on. But sort of what are Hunter and Stephanie's relationship to Vince? What is Shane's relationship to Vince? How all that goes, because there's been some stuff that's happened in recent years that's kind of like, ooh, that's going to make Christmas awkward.
There's a lot of things that make Christmas awkward there.
There's a lot of things, and I'm sure that's not the first time things have been awkward at a McMahon family Christmas, but just, I think there's a lot more there that we're going to learn that maybe we don't want to learn, but we're going to find out anyway, because it's going to be like a train wreck and we just can't look away.
It's going to be something.
I also find it interesting. I mean, obviously, the timing of the release is, I know it's been planned, but it's just really kind of funny because with Rob moving to Netflix at the beginning of the year and this getting released,
you get this out now before Rob moves there.
Yeah, you have to get it out in front of it and just get it done. And just, I'm honestly surprised they're going to release it.
I'm not. It's, I didn't Netflix, think they would. If there was a conviction, probably I don't not. Think it. I don't think it makes air. But because everything's gotten delayed for Discovery and stuff, they had time to get it out.
That's fair. So moving on to the A of the E of the W's, AEW announces Grand Slam Australia Stadium Show will be on February 15th, 2025. Tickets go on sale soon.
Tickets do go on sale soon. That's a big one for them. They're expanding their horizons. This is the first show in Australia. They're doing a big stadium show. They got out in front of it, picking days in February before WWE can put the dates out there. So you kind of pick and choose. Now the biggest question, and I forgot to ask this, of Brent, but I'll ask him at some point. Will he get up at 4 a.m. to watch AEW Grand Slam?
Will he go to bed? That's the better question.
Will he stay up and watch the Australia show like he did the WWE Australia show last February?
Will he do the thing? Because, I mean, the other question you can ask him is he going to get up early to watch Forbidden Door, which is taking place on August 24th, 2025 in London?
That one's going to be in the afternoon. He'll be awake for that one. That one's more, that's easier, because we just watched the London show. We just watched the show in London.
Right, but remember for him, the pre-show started at like 8 a.m.
Yeah, fair.
So you don't have to be up early, but you do have to get up.
Here's the thing, we usually don't review Forbidden Door, so he don't have to watch it right away. He can watch it whenever.
He must watch it now, goddammit. Right now. I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding.
No, you're not.
And in more good news for AEW, because I have no transition for that, Swerve Strickland signed his contract extension with AEW live on the pay-per-view, so congratulations to him.
That was so weird. That was such a filler segment on the buy-in show. Like, oh, he signed a contract. Okay. Then lost the title 5 hours later, so neat.
But the ink's dry on the contract, so they're good.
The ink is dry. It is dry on the contract. He's Swerve. That's for sure.
And then, in no surprise to anybody, Ricochet is All Elite.
Made his debut at All In and a part of the Casino Gauntlet.
Which got he did not first, win.
He did not win. He got his first singles win on last night on Dynamite. They teased him and Will Ospreay for the future because that's everyone's dream match. So it is what it is. I hope he finds success. Well, we talked about it on Not So Live. There's a ceiling. And there's a path for him to be world champion, and there's a path that he doesn't get to be world champion. It all depends how they book things and how he defines. It all depends on how he himself defines success going forward. Because he can win a bunch of matches and sort of win a championship here or there and never become world champion, or does he define success as being world champion like Swerve got to be, or if he's just about having good matches and making memories. And if that's the case, then he'll have all the success in the world, I hope. I hope his run is successful, and I hope he doesn't get forgotten in 3 months and sort of just becomes a guy. If they're going to use him, I hope they have an actual plan for him and not just sort of, oh yeah, he wanted to come here, so he's there, and now go watch him on Rampage in 3 months.
I'll second all of that. I hope it works out for him the way that he wants, we don't know what he wants.
Yeah, he didn't think he was. You don't know what he wanted. Thought of his run in WWE, but everyone thinks he wanted more out of it. He's like, okay, great. But this goes with everybody. Everyone wants to be the man. Not everyone can be.
Agreed. But with that, I say we take a break, and when we come back, we're going to be talking all about Bash in Berlin, which is going to be taking place this weekend. Sorry. Live on the Peacocks and the WWE Network, so you don't want to miss it. You're listening to The Rack right here on wildtalkradio.com, and we'll be right back.
Are you following us on twitch.tv/WTR Live? Do you have Amazon Prime? If so, you can link it to your Twitch account and subscribe to our Twitch channel for free with Twitch Prime. It's the easiest way to help support us for free.
This just into the CB Radio news desk. Sources have confirmed that CB Radio will be live Saturday nights at 11:30 p.m. Eastern.
Wasn't this confirmed last year?
Yes.
Then how is this breaking news?
No one said it was breaking news. We here at the CB Radio News Desk are just confirming what has already been confirmed.
To confirm, you are just confirming that CB Radio is live Saturday nights at 11:30 p.m. Eastern.
Confirmed. We would like to remind you. Always trust the source that confirms that CB Radio is live Saturday nights at 11:30 p.m. Eastern.
Confirmed.
Confirmed.
Like what you hear? Subscribe to The Rack on Apple Podcasts. Just search for The Rack Radio Show. And while you're there, leave us a review and tell us your thoughts on your favorite show on a Thursday night.
Every Sunday night, the evolution continues with Wrestle Talk Radio, giving you all the latest happenings in sports entertainment. With the intern, the producer, the original Tim Stein, and sometimes, a K-Sheep. It's WTR Sunday night, 10 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Mountain, only on the Wild Talk Radio Network.
Every Monday night, once Monday Night Raw ends, the Raw post-show goes live.
You want to hear a story? Get the hell yeah!
Join Lindsey and Sir Rockin as they give their opinions on what they liked,
what
they didn't like,
What?
And what left them completely confused.
What?
It's the Raw Post Show.
What?
Monday nights.
What?
11 p.m. Eastern.
What?
Live on the Wild Talk Radio Network.
And that's the bottom line. Go Stone, go Simpson.
Did you know you can use support a creator code ROCKNSOCK in the Fortnite item shop? That's ROCKNSOCK in the Fortnite item shop. That's a hashtag ad, because we are a hashtag epic partner.
Hello, this is WWE Hall of Famer, the Heartbreak Kid, Shawn Michaels, and you're listening to Rack Radio.
And during the few moments that we have left, we want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand.
And welcome back to The Rack right here on WildTalkRadio.com. Brought to our friends over at MBG Films. Check them out at YouTube.com/MBG1211. Mouth is still mouthing. If you're listening to us over on RockRadioShow.com, WildTalkRadio.com, or directly on Twitch, thank you so much for tuning in. We greatly appreciate it. If you're on Twitch and you have to have a Prime Gaming sub available, we can use it here for free for 30 days. All you have to do is hit the little purple button down at the bottom of the screen and you can subscribe for free. It is that simple. You can also subscribe the regular way, follow the channel, hang out and chat, or listen to the archive. We are happy to have you any way we can get you. And with that, we are talking all about WWE Bash in Berlin,
which is live this Saturday on the Peacocks at 1 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m., 8 a.m. on the West Coast. Check your local listings for time and availability in your area. I assume the kickoff's probably an hour before. They have not announced it yet, unless they have and I haven't seen it. But we'll see. There's a press conference tomorrow at 10 a.m. for the, not press conference, but the gathering, the kickoff gathering tomorrow at 10 a.m. Eastern. So, yeah, it should be an interesting five-card show. Five-match show on Saturday.
Which they kind of indicated and announced that 5 to 6 matches is going to pretty much be the norm from here on out, that they're liking the shorter format. It's easier to work with.
It is.
It's good for the fans because you get them in and out kind of thing.
Pushes TV more, gives you big matches on TV. It gives you a three and a half hour experience for the premium live event. You give more time to the performers. You're not rushing through anything. And you're sort of like, because they have, and this could all change in a year or two, their strategy with premium events. But with how they're doing them right now, and the what people don't understand is, well, there's a lot of downtime between stuff. Yes, but they have requirements with Peacock, where they have to run advertising. They have to run, in between every match, there has to be some sort of advertising that they run. So there's going to be some downtime with that, and then WWE has to run their own stuff. So it's a combination of they're going to do their own video package and advertising plus the Peacock advertising. So it has to sort of, there's going to be 5 to 7 minutes between matches because that's just the nature of everything. So you, for every premium live event, you're going to lose 30 plus minutes just for that because that's the requirements of the arrangement they have with Peacock. If and when it moves all to Netflix, you're probably not going to have that. You'll probably have No, you're still going to probably have it, thinking about it, because Netflix is running ads now. So you're always going to have a time gap.
Yep.
Like if you run traditional pay-per-view, you wouldn't have it. You would have a 3-4 minute downtime. And that's about it. Here you're going to have extended downtime. And guess what? I like it because I'm able to get up. I'm able to tweet all my thoughts out when I need to. I can get a snack. I can go to the bathroom. I could just absorb everything that I have just seen.
As opposed to match after match after match after match after match.
Which I did Sunday from 11 a.m. on. Which you didn't, absorb anything. It just sort of, yeah. And as Mercedes mentioned, there was crowd fatigue during her match. Well, that's part of the reason why it's not a great match. But there was crowd fatigue because they had just she said it herself. There was 10 matches before her. Of course, there's going to be crowd fatigue at some point, and it happened to be in their match, which is the point of don't overload your shows.
Right.
Like WrestleMania.
Quality over quantity.
Yeah, WrestleMania, 7 matches, 8 matches a night. It works.
That's doable. That's totally doable.
Especially in a 4.5 hour time, 4.5 hour time span. So I'm good with how their shows are because if you look at what we did, we watched Monday, Bo and Chad would have not got the 15, 20 minutes they got on a pay-per-view.
No, they wouldn't have.
They would have got 7 minutes in and out, 10 minutes with the entrances, and they would have been forgettable. You got a big main event on Raw with two people who probably would not have had that much time. And they've been lost in the shuffle. So their strategy is working, especially when it's going to come to the new year and everything's going to be like, hey, SmackDown on USA gets a big match and Netflix on Raw gets a big match or two. It's kind of the way the world works now. But yeah, but let's dive into the show.
All right. So like we mentioned, 5-match card. This has been kind of a quiet, soft build on certain areas, but still a very good build to this show. Should be exciting. We're going to open with the Unholy Union, Alba Fire and Isla Dawn taking on Bianca Belair and Jade Cargill. This is for the tag team championships, the women's, just to clarify that. Isla Dawn and Alba Fire are your champions. They took them off Bianca and Jade.
Back at Clash at the Castle. Is when they won.
In a surprise.
It was a surprise. And they've done a decent job. People say, oh, it's a little bit forgettable reign. I mean, they've had a couple title defenses. They've been featured a lot more on television than they were previously. Could they have done better? Yes. But making strides. They've been pushing this rematch for a while. Bianca and Jade have been waiting for their opportunity. There was a triple threat match a few weeks ago that they got screwed out of. I think it was a triple threat that they got screwed out of the title win and stuff. So they've done a good job of like spreading out because when they originally lost it, we thought, okay, they'll get the belts right back. It was like going to be a quick title change. I was like, no, they've given them. Clash at the Castle was what, June?
So June, yeah.
So we're about two plus months, about 100 days, something like that, close to. Maybe 90 days as champions. I mean, it's not
June 15th.
June 15th, I mean, that's not bad. Two and a half months reign, I mean, that's pretty good.
That's respectable.
Yeah. And who knows, they could keep them on Saturday. I don't think so. I think they give the belts back to Bianca and Jade because I think they want to feature them more coming in the fall, but it was a very respectable. It's been a very respectable title reign compared to what other title reigns have been for the tag titles. I mean, they've done a good job. They're going to be featured more, and I think it's going to be a really good match. They've worked well with Bianca and Jade so far. I think come Saturday they'll have another good match, and they'll have a bit of time to sort of flesh out the match and kind of tell a good story. I think I'm going to give it to Bianca and Jay to regain the belts, but it wouldn't surprise me if Jade and Bianca get kind of screwed by someone. I don't know by who, but
maybe Baszler and Stark.
Maybe for getting in their way. Maybe for getting in their way. Maybe. But I think Jade and Bianca capture the belts.
I like that they're trying to make the division competitive. I like that they're trying to do something, really anything with the division. That's amazing. And we've kind of been in the period for a long time with long title reigns. Like somebody wins a title and they hold it for at least a year, which is not a bad thing. But to me, I feel like you need to maybe have some of the titles move and shift, especially if you want that competitive edge to that division where it's very hotly contested. Everybody's sort of on equal footing. It can move at any point. It's not that expected. Oh, well, it's this show, so it's not going to move, right? Because these people are the champions. They're targeting this. So it screws up their plans if they do anything. So you know automatically it's not going to move. It's very predictable. So the fact that they're sort of adding that unpredictability to the division by having the title move, having it be very competitive, having everything that they're having right now with it, I think is very, very good. We've also been making Alba Fire and Isla Dawn with this, which is important because they kind of brought them up and then they sort of didn't do anything with them for a long time. So the fact that you're doing something with them is very important because Bianca and Jade are stars on their own, right? Like, Bianca has a list of accomplishments a mile long. Jade has a list of accomplishments, not quite as long as Bianca's, but she'll get there. And they will make her into a star. So they can sort of, like, they don't need it as badly, especially since they had the titles before and they were so dominant with the titles. So giving it to Alba and giving it to Isla was good. I think, though, you can put them back on Bianca and Jade. But honestly, I kind of want to see Alba and Isla hold their own against them. I kind of want to see them retain. I'm going to go with Alba and Isla.
Yeah, I'm going to go Jade and Bianca. 8-ball, do the champs retain? Don't count on it. Just don't count on it. Okay. So now, go to the wheel.
Wrestler 2.
Wrestler 2. That would be the challengers.
Wouldn't that be the challengers?
All right, then.
You're doomed. You're doomed. You realize this, right? They both agreed with you. You're doomed.
I'll say another one. I'll say, or are you doomed?
I could be. We don't know.
We'll find out.
We will. So up next, we have in a strap match, which this should be very, very good. CM Punk taking on Drew McIntyre. This has been a very hot, highly contested feud. We've had a lot of back and forth. We've had suspensions. We've had beatdowns. We've had insults. We've had property getting stolen. We've had all the things in this feud. It's been wonderful. Drew has been living his best heel life. I will say he's been doing probably some of the best work he's ever done in this feud. Just because he's been so, so good in it.
Uh-huh.
And Punk, I will give Punk his flowers in this. Punk has responded admirably. He's done a good job of being the babyface while still maintaining his CM Punk-ness. But yeah, there's been some really, really wonderful stuff happening in this feud. It's been very well written. This started way back at the beginning of the year, and now we're here to a strap match. I expect these two to beat the high holy hell out of each other. It's a four corner strap match too.
Yes.
Which means they have to touch all four corners in order to win the match, which always makes it that much more fun. Yeah, I just expect this to be brutal. Absolutely brutal. I expect them to go to town on each other.
Their backs are going to
be red. Which they should.
Their backs are going to be red on Saturday. They're going to be sore.
There's
going to
be welts upon welts.
I hope Punk comes out of it okay. It'll be, because that's just what you hope for these days. You hope he comes out healthy. Mm-hmm. Especially in a gimmick match. I think he'll be all right. I think this will be a good match. I think Punk's going to come out with the win, because you can have this is where you can have the babyface win and then kind of sneak the win, as it were, with the random touching of the corners. Drew's going to make him earn it. That's for sure. He's going to have to earn it. But I got Punk winning this one, sending it to Hell in a Cell. Because Drew here, when the feud's over, there's no reason for a third match.
Yeah, I kind of got to give it to Punk if they're going to go for a third. Get the win just to sort of like overcome, because like he almost needs it in a weird way. So yeah, I can see Punk winning. That's a good plan.
Like Drew can touch all three and goes to the fourth, and Punk sneakily has touched three as well, and then sneaks in, gets the fourth, gets his ass beat afterwards, leading to Hell in a Cell. It could happen. We'll see. 8-ball, does CM Punk win? Ask again.
Oh, damn it.
Wheel.
Wrestler 2.
Which is who?
Drew McIntyre.
8-ball Drew? Outlook not so good. So 8-ball's going with CM Punk.
Up next, we have a grudge match, which is a mixed tag team match. The Terror Twins, Damian Priest and Rhea Ripley, take on the Judgment Day, featuring Dominic Mysterio and Liv Morgan, and I want to see Dominic get his ass beat by Rhea. Liv is whatever. I want to see that boy get beat up by Rhea so bad. Give it to me. Please give it to me. I want to see her just absolutely annihilate him. Because it will be entertaining as all hell.
It would be
like
very
Liv is Liv. Liv is Liv, right? Liv is Liv. Y'all all know my feelings on that. I don't need to voice them again, but what do you think on it?
I'm looking forward to seeing the interactions. I think you'll get a couple Dom and Rhea moments. I think Rhea will hit Riptide on him at some point, which for a big pop from the crowd. In terms of like the story sense of it, they mentioned Sunday about interference, and I could see a lot of that kind of happening. There's a way, part of me thinks Rhea pins Liv and that makes her number one contender again. But I go also kind of buy the idea that Finn interferes and costs Damian the match and kind of sort of pushes that over. This is the one really match on the show where I go, it's 50-50 on who wins, because you can get to the singles matches any way you want from this. Like, Rhea technically doesn't have to beat Liv to get another title shot. She can get the title shot whenever based on how they do the division. Would it make sense that way? Yeah. Yes. But you can always get the title shot no matter what. So Liv and Dom winning here, I think that would be the bigger thing. Liv and Dom winning, because they're technically underdogs in this one, would be the bigger deal. Yeah, I think I'm going to go... I think Liv and Dom sneak out a win. I think, based on the rest of the show, yeah, I think they need the win, and it will kind of further, like, the annoyance it is for Rhea and Damian and lead to other matches. So, yeah, I'm going Liv and Dom take it.
I think they get the interference, but I think it's because they can't win. But the other side of that I could see is that Finn tries to cost them, and... The one thing that they've been doing is that Dominic and Rhea, they're playing them very smart. They've been able to get Liv and Dominic's and Judgment Day's goat on numerous occasions. And they've only, like, in terms of the other side with Finn in the group, they haven't really been able to catch Rhea and Damian unawares too often. In fact, I think this week was kind of the first week that they were able to really trap them and kind of outsmart them. And that's really going to be the story of this match. And the question is how prepared are Rhea and Damian for that interference? Because one of the things they were talking about on Sunday as well was backup. And could they get backup? And we kind of saw the LWO sort of get up in Judgment Day's business a little bit this week, where that's where they're going to move Judgment Day to after kind of this feud with Damian and Rhea, you know, is completed. They're going to move the group onto the LWO. So could we see the LWO sort of help sort that out for Damian and Rhea, where it's like, yeah, no, these guys, we don't really like you guys, but we hate these guys worse, so we'll help you out. Because they're kind of bitches, especially since Ray's the leader.
I don't know if they go back to the LWO feud. I think that one's kind of over and done with.
I don't know, but you could see it happen. Like, you could see sort of like Ray provide some kind of distraction, or Ray do something to sort of like teach Dominic a lesson.
Oh, I can see them being the backup. I don't think a feud will come out of it, though.
I mean, that's fair. But I don't know. Like, I want Rhea and Damian to get a win over Dominic and Liv, just because I really want to see it. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it puts them in sort of a stronger position, because especially with Rhea losing the title because of Dominic, and then Damian losing the title because of Finn, you sort of need to have that win for them just to keep them going, because I feel like if they lose here, it sort of like takes a lot of the wind out of their sails. So they get that win and like they could get beat down afterwards. That's, you know, that's completely fine. Or you have like a no contest, since there's no stipulation, I think, on this one beyond the mixed tag. You could have a DQ here where Rhea and Damian technically get the win, but due to the interference by Finn, there's not a real winner. There's nobody that gets pinned. Because that's really the complication is, you know, if Rhea or Damian get pinned, well, that sort of weakens them out a little bit, which you don't want right now because you're trying to build them up even further. Like, I think Rhea could eat it and probably be okay, but you'd have to, like, essentially give her a win back to sort of, like, maintain her dominance. And then on the other side, it's like you want Dominic and Liv to look strong because they're the bad guys in their heels, even though they're the cowardly heels. And you have Finn sort of get involved. But if they eat a pin, it's slightly less damning because it's, well, you deserved it. And it's that feel-good moment of you deserved it, and Rhea and Damian kind of get that little bit of vengeance against them for that. But then you have sort of Judgment Day descend down upon them afterwards, because it's like they're weak, they're tired, let's go, let's get them. You know what, I want Rhea and Damian to win. I'm going Rhea and Damian.
Eight ball Rhea and Damian. No wheel.
Wrestler one,
which is
Wrestler one is the Terror Twins.
There you go.
Up next for the undisputed former UBU WWE Championship, you have Cody Rhodes taking on Kevin Owens in a singles match, no stipulation. I love Kevin Owens so much.
The teases,
like, just his sense of...
Go ahead.
The sense of humor is everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's just incredible.
So he doesn't believe he earned it, but he's getting the title shot, and everyone believes he's going to turn his back on Cody Rhodes. All the things. Kevin did a great job with the teases and breaking the fourth wall. Like, hey, I want the tag. We're setting up a tag match, and we get the tag match, and yeah, do I still have time to kick his ass? Like, yeah. And then the teases with the belt. Like, everyone knows the routine, and he kind of knows what's happening and plays into it. Could be a really good match. I think they're going to tear the house down, but Cody's retaining. So that's the one thing about the top two matches on the show. There's not really a, I don't know, thought that
it's
either.
Predictable.
Very predictable, yes. They're both very predictable. Like, they're going to be really great wrestling matches, very enjoyable to watch, but there's not going to be a moment where you go, oh, they're actually going to put the belt on Kevin. Or they're actually going to put the belt on Randy. They're just two very predictable matches. And that's not a bad thing. It's just the way it is. Like, last month at SummerSlam was the first time I thought, okay, there's a chance that Solo could get the belt. That was the first time I was like, Cody's could drop it. It was mainly I wanted to see it just to freshen up the title picture a little bit. And put Cody back on the chase because he's better with the chase. And I've always said that with the babyface champion. It's... they're always better on the chase. And it goes back to, like, the wrestling in the 90s where it's like, even the, we'll stay with the Attitude Era. Like, Stone Cold's peak, he was losing the belt, being screwed out of the belt, and getting it right back. John Cena, Randy Orton, title reigns were 6 months, maybe, but then they were losing and getting the belts back. Like, a loss, losing the belt, winning the belt back is why 15-time world champions, 16-time world champions. And it didn't hurt anyone when they lost it. Chasing the belt back is not a bad thing. I'll just put them together with the Gunther for the world title. It's too early for that to happen since he just won it. So it's like, there's no way Randy's going to win the belt. This is more to define the match that they had at King and Queen of the Ring where their shoulders were up. This is to settle it once and for all. So Gunther's going to walk away with the belt. Just like Cody's going to walk away with the belt here.
Yeah. I agree with that. You know, as much as we all love Kevin, because I'm going to stay on Kevin because we need to talk about Gunther and Randy separate. As much as we love Kevin, as much as we would love to see Kevin as champion, it's not moving. They're not going to take it off Cody unless they just really want to surprise everybody. They're not going to take it off Cody. And then there's really no reason to take it off Cody. Again, unless you just really want to surprise someone. And I feel like those days of just doing things for shits and giggles are kind of over, right? Like those days of just doing things because you could do them because they don't make sense. They don't do that too much anymore because that was done purely to entertain Vince. Like if Hunter Hunt does a surprise, he does it with intent and he does it with a purpose. And there's but there's generally a logical reason behind why Hunter does something like that when he books it like that.
Yeah, they know the next step in the story before they even do the surprise. They already have it planned out. So it may be a surprise for us, but they already have it mapped out to like, hey, this is why this is going to go there here and why this does this. That's why it's like, I look at the match and it's like, as surprising as it would be, like, okay, to play that card of, hey, Kevin Owens wins, it's because the bloodline interferes and costs Cody. But the bloodline is not going to do that because the bloodline is more focused about getting the belt themselves rather than taking off of Cody. So I think I don't see that happening here.
And they want Cody as champion so they can beat him.
Yeah.
Kevin's great. We all love Kevin. But they want Cody. They're after Cody. Do I expect the bloodline to appear after this match? Sure. Those of them that can go. I'm not sure who all can go.
The only one I haven't know of, I don't know if over there yet is Solo, but the other three were already.
So I would expect them to, I don't know if I would expect them to interfere in this match. I think this is just going to be a straight up Cody versus Kevin banger match. And this will be very, very good. And then I expect the shenanigans to happen after the match or possibly throughout the night. Where maybe the bloodline attacks Cody and they sort of weaken him to try and like cost him and Kevin's like, because it's like face versus face. So it's like Kevin, I don't know if Kevin would do the honorable thing. I don't know if he would fight Cody if he was weakened, or if he would just be like, yeah, no, I'm not. I don't want any part of this. Or if Kevin ends up helping Cody with the bloodline, and maybe they, I don't think they'll turn it into a tag match. I doubt they would do that.
No.
It eventually leads to like a tag match or something like that.
Playing the bloodline card was just a speculation of that's the only way I could see that Kevin winning. I don't even expect the bloodline to be on this show.
I have no idea. But I know this match will be very good, and I know Cody's going to win. So Cody Rhodes.
Cody, 8-ball. Cody, better not tell me. So you're going to tell me in a second, but we're going to spin the wheel.
Wrestler 2.
That's Kevin.
Mm-hmm.
8-ball Kevin. Yes, definitely.
Okay. All right. And since we brought it up, Gunther versus Randy Orton. This is a singles match for the World Heavyweight Championship. If Orton wins and he gets the title, he will be transferred to Raw. And if Gunther will go to SmackDown since they're on opposite brands. I expect this to be a good match. I expected this to be a hard-hitting match. I expect Randy to show up for this. Because if Randy does, it'll be very good. Gunther will be Gunther, and he'll do his thing. I expect somebody to lose a titty in this. So, you know, watch eBay, because something's getting slapped off. But this has been an interesting feud. Like, there's been some good moments in it. It hasn't been, like, my most favorite feud. It hasn't necessarily been the hottest feud. Like, they've done a couple, like, in altercations and beatdowns. You've had Kaiser get back involved with things, so he showed back up. And they're doing this in Germany, which is not Gunther's home country. He's Austrian, but it's close to his home country. So I imagine his family will be in attendance for this as well. I see, no offense to Randy, no reason to put this on Randy. No reason to give him the title, and I'm not entirely sure if he wants it.
I mean, I think he would take it at this point, because the schedule's not bad anymore. There's 1 weekend of house shows, maybe a month at this point. So having the title is not what it was. He's not going on the road 200, 300 days with the title anymore. Gunther's retaining. The feud is what it is. This match is happening only because they said it had to happen after King and the Queen of the Ring. That's the only reason this is happening. So they've trash talked their way here. And here we are. It's Gunther winning. He's retaining the belt. It's simple, easy. It's logical booking. Gunther retains.
You know what? Yeah. Have Randy lose. Have him go back to SmackDown. Have him face off against Cody and hit the Randy Orton, Cody Rhodes feud that they know we all want. Where you touch on all that history. Because, oh my goodness gracious, is there history between those two? But yeah.
Yeah.
I will say expect this to be nasty, like I said. So, yeah. But Gunther's going to win.
Yeah, this is, like I said, these two top matches, nothing's going to change hands. And if it does, there's an injury, and that's the only reason they change hands. Beyond that, it's going to be simple and to the point. Gunther retains. 8-ball Gunther? Yes. Wheel? What do you say?
Wrestler 2.
That'd be Randall.
Okay. The wheel's making moves.
But yeah, the wheel's making moves, that's for sure.
But that does it for us.
It does. They'll do it for the Rack Live right here on the Wild Talk Radio Network tomorrow night, 10-ish PM Eastern. We'll be GM battles. Get back into it and see who can come out on top. Saturday night, 10 PM Eastern, WGR game night. Followed by CB Radio Live at 11:30 PM Eastern. Sundays, WTF Sunday Muscle Talk Radio. Reviewing Bash in the Lid. Monday nights, Raw Post Show, 11 PM Eastern. We'll be back next Thursday night, 10 PM Eastern, to talk all things Bash in Berlin. You can check out CB Radio Not So Live review of AEW All In, now available. It's at Wild Talk Radio. It's Facebook.com. It's Wild Talk Radio Network. Chat, if you have that Amazon Prime link to your Twitch account, it's called Prime Gaming Support Channel, by clicking the purple rectangle button below the screen. You can also use credit code RockSock or
Lindsey Ward
in the Fortnite item shop or Epic Game Store when you buy Wolverine, Deadpool, and everything else, because we are
Hashtag Epic Partners. You can follow me on most of the social medias at Lindsey Ward, LNSWRD. You can check me out on Twitch, twitch.tv/Lindsey Ward, where we have been streaming Not Lawn for Genshin Impact, the brand new patch that just dropped this past week.
We are in search of the Harbinger Capitano. Will we find him? You'll have to check the stream out and see. You can also follow me on youtube.com/@SimileLindsWard, and you can follow me over on TikTok, LindsWard0. And while you're liking and subscribing and doing all the things, you can hit up Matt's channel, MBG Films, youtube.com/MBG1211, and view all his amazing content and like it and subscribe to it and tell him we said hi, because he's an awesome person. So for Rock, I'm Lindsey Ward. You've been listening to Rock right here on WildTalkRadio.com, and we will see you next week. Till then, bye!
WildTalkRadio.com.